This tutorial is going to be covering the basics and the fundamentals of 2D graphing within Manim. We're going to be ranging from axis and number plane all the way through to a polar plane with some updaters. Now let's have a look at what's happening here. We are adding an axis, we are getting some labels to the axis, we're moving it around on the screen before we animate it out, and we're also going to be adding a graph to this particular axis. Now notice when I call the graph, I've got this axis.getGraph statement there. That means I'm calling the graph to the particular axis I've created. You'll also notice I've created a group, and I'm going to be moving the group and then only moving the axis, just to show you that if you want to shift everything around, then you've got to create a vector group. Take another look at it. I've created a vector group. I'm creating the axis and the graph, and then I'm going to be moving the vector group, which is all of the stuff I've got, and then I'm moving the axis, which is Manim's doing exactly what it should do. But if you don't understand why it's doing that, you're going to get a headache. Looking into a different example here, we're going to be using a number plane. We're going to call a function on our plane, and we're also going to call an area under the curve. Now, the nice part here is that Manim has got some built-in functions, but if you're calling them onto the number plane, you must use the name of your number plane. What I've also done here is created a label for my function, and I've moved it up from the plane. You'll also see the last part of this code, I've got a horizontal line, which I've just defined it as a line by calling the start and the endpoints from myplane.c2p, which stands for coordinate to point. Again, pause it, read the code, look at where it's supposed to be on the axis, and then watch how it plays out. As a final point for this animation, notice how I've got the plane and I've shifted it to the right 3 units. That's exactly where it's sitting with respect to the background plane. We'll check out another example here where I'm calling multiple axis and number planes on the same scene. Have a look at the code and see if you can understand why that animation has played out the way it has. Notice in the code how the first part I've got everything on the number plane, and in the second part I've got everything on the axis. I've shifted one to the left and one to the right so they don't overlap. And then when I call the animation, they're going to be created separately. And to reiterate, when I'm calling elements onto the axis, I've got to call them onto the particular plane or axis I want. Let's talk through the code of this polar plane. You can see that I have got a polar plane and I've also got an axis on the screen at the same time. Now, the method that I've done here is I've got plane, which is a polar plane. Okay, and what I've also got is I've got axis and I have added my axis. So I've got my two coordinate systems on the screen at the same time. This one I've shifted to the left there for my plane, and my axis all the way over here, I've got it shifted to the right. Now, in order to get them both to create at the same time, I'm gonna be using a value tracker, which as a note is tracking the end value of the function. So I want the functions to always be updating on their plane respectively. And I'm gonna use the same endpoint for both of my functions. So here I've got my graph one there. And again, I've got this always red raw, which is really just saying always update, where it's a parametric function and I'm calling the point, polar to point. So it's like coordinate to point on the polar plane for the polar plane that is called plane. That's this one here. Okay, if you call your plane, I don't know, G for, for whatever reason, then you've got to go G. dot polar. Okay, so you're calling to that particular plane because you can have multiple on the screen. Now this is polar coordinate, so we go r comma theta, where you want your r value, the radius, to be given by that function, and then you want the theta value to just be given by the value of t, where t ranges from 0 to the end value. So this always needs to, this needs to be always red raw because this is going to be constantly updating with this value tracker given up there. Now for the nice effect, I've added a dot, and this dot I want to always have it on the end of the graph. So again, this is going to be constantly updating, hence the always red raw statement. If anything's moving or if anything's updating, just slap an always red raw there. Okay, and within the always red raw statement, so you're opening this up here and you're saying everything within here is going to be constantly updated, and I want it to move it to graph one, which is our polar graph, and get end, right? And then that closing off bracket is closing off anything that you want to be updated with that dot. Similar drill, right? Graph 2, always red rule because I want it to be constantly updating such that the x value here at the end, it's got an end value of E, which is given by the same value tracker. So the value tracker is going to be tracking the end of graph 1 here, and it's also going to be tracking the end of graph 2 there. Okay, again, I've got the same effect with dot 2, always red rule, so always update me. And I want it to move it to graph 2, get end. So move it to this graph and get the end of the graph. Okay, I've just added a title in there and then I play my animation out. And once again, all of the power is happening in this statement here. E.animate.setValue to become pi. Okay, and moving along, well, this animation is gonna last for 10 seconds. That's it. So the playing itself is just write the playing, create the axis, create the title, add graph 1, graph 2, dot 1, dot 2, and like nothing will show up initially, but then things will show up because you can see graph 1, dot 1, graph 2, dot 2. You can see all of those things, 1, 2, 3, 4, are all given by updaters. All of those mobjects there have the always red rule statement. So when you add them and then play the value tracker out, those objects, 1, 2, 3, 4, are going to update with respect to this value tracker.